So, fall break, everybody had a good fall break? Get some time off, away, up, down, whatever? No? Okay. Do it. Well, are we ready to dive back into computer music then? Everybody's just shell shocked from fall break? Is that why everyone's so quiet or just. It was like so epic that you can't even put into words what fall break was. Yes, okay. Okay. Well, we are starting the process of a new project, and that means finishing up the previous project. So let me turn back to you your rubrics from the previous project. The grades are obviously on Blackboard, and hopefully you took a chance to see those prior to today, but this gives you more detail about it. I think overall, obviously, as I mentioned on the presentation days, one group didn't use an USB controller, one group didn't use the previous synthesis, so I tried to let that be a wash. But I did think about it in terms of the overall grades. I do think that perhaps some of it was the fact that I let you kind of explore various topics. I felt like there wasn't as much focus to some of the points that you guys were trying to get across. Also, I felt like there was, I think that the PowerPoint slides could be more concise still, too. There was some improvement from Project 1 to Project 2, but I think even more they could be concise for Project 3 and 4. Let me think. There are also some groups where I wasn't sure. Maybe this was a symptom of having bigger groups. I wasn't sure who did what in the group, and it wasn't explicitly stated. So it's okay to have a slide where you just say, this person was responsible for this. This person was, even if it's this person researched the history and prepared the slides. This person did this. This person, actually did the bulk of the implementation, and then we all met together. As long as you're communicating and you're delegating roles, I'm fine with that, basically. These projects are designed to be bigger than any one person can handle. That's part of the design of them, to force you to work together, to rely on each other, to divide things up. I think where things felt vague, obviously I'm looking at just one, not the other one, I think that might have been, as I said, not giving you specific topics. So I am going to give you specific topics this next time around. One group went way over time, but that was partly my fault because you asked how much time you had left, and I said 5 minutes, but you had already gone 13 minutes at that point. So, and we only had two presentations, so you could go a little bit over, but try to. It still felt like you were slow at various points, so that's kind of what I honed in on the time there. I'm trying to think what else. One group had sound examples, the other one didn't have sound examples. You'll see some numbers at the bottom of page 2 as I was adding up how many items you had in the exemplary category, the acceptable category, the developing category, and the unacceptable category. That's what that was. And it pretty much was the same distribution in both groups. It's just that where one group was strong, the other one was weak, and where one, and vice versa, basically. So that's where, as you mix up your groups, as we mix up the groups again, be having conversations with each other about what, you don't have to talk about what grade you got if you're not comfortable with that, but if you could talk about what did Wallach say you did well in your group, basically, so that and report to your other group members, okay, well, he said we did well in this area, so maybe we should be more like this and more like that in those specific areas, basically, okay? So think think some more about how you can kind of collaborate, not just on the actual topic content, but also in terms of figuring out what went well in one group's presentation versus another group's presentation and picking the best of each group, basically, so that we get stronger presentations overall in this next round, okay? Are there other questions, general questions that you guys have about the rubrics or the grades or... Everybody got their midterm grade. You can see your midterm average. That, again, factors in 20 points for Project 1, 20 points for Project 2, and 10 points for the readings, which technically you could have earned 12 points for the readings because there were six of them. Same is true for the second half of the semester. There's six more readings. You could earn 12 more points, basically. So there's we're at the fall break mark, at the midterm grade, we've actually got 50 points in the bank, basically, toward your final grade. Okay, you can think of it that way. That's one of the reasons why I give you both the raw score and the letter grade, so you can see like how many points you've got in the bank. My offer for last project stands also for this project, that if you'd like to watch the presentation and write a 300 words last time, response to it, that'll be good for three extra points toward this, which is actually worth more than a single reading reflection. So if you missed one of those, you can actually make up one and a half of them by doing the reading reflection. Some of you are going to look at this, the numeric grade on this, and think, you know, I need those 3 points to get to what I wanted to get on this project grade. So however you think of it, those 3 points should be valuable to all of you in helping your grades for the class overall. It doesn't take that much effort, and the reason for giving you bonus points for it is because I believe in the ability for you to improve your presentation skills by reflecting back and watching what you presented previously. Yeah.
I just had a question about the grades. It says out of 52, does that include the two assignments that are not due until next week and the following week?
I think it's because there's technically 12 points you could have gotten for reading reflections, because there's six reading reflections times two, that's 12 points. That's where the 52 comes from. But I think separate from that, I inputted a midterm average grade.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
All
right. That's not, the 52 is just a simple, Blackboard is tallying, and so it's not going to factor in the fact that there's actually extra points being worked out as far as extra credit and those sorts of things. My midterm average actually totals it up in terms of it being out of 50 points, basically. Okay. Okay. So, checking in, we've already started talking about midterm grades. You had a reading reflection due today, which I actually read most of them this morning, so good. People are on top of that. As I said before the break, I've moved the deadline to those to be the start of class on Tuesday. You should put those, make sure you're staying on top of those. There is one every week for the next couple of weeks. And those are all set up in the reading reflections folder on Blackboard, okay? We're starting Project 3 today, and I'll get into that momentarily. But one side note, which I think I mentioned, I think I had on your syllabus, but if not, sorry. But next Tuesday, we actually have a guest here, Jonty Harrison, who is a electroacoustic composer from the UK, is here regionally. He's actually working over at the Atlantic Center for the Arts with several associate artists. If you're not familiar with the Atlantic Center for the Arts, it's over in New Smyrna Beach. They usually invite in people that are at the top of their game artistically in groups of three and from three different media, so they actually talk to each other. That's one of the nice things about the residency program there. But then what those three artists do while they're in residence is they actually, people that are earlier in their career, like students, grad students, early career artists, actually apply to study with them for 3 weeks, basically. So these three master artists are in residence over at the ACA, and each of them, I think, has 7 to 10 associate artists that are like studying with them. So think of it as like... you get to have personal private lessons with that person for 3 weeks, and also group lessons with that person, with the other associate artists. So there's a lot of exchange of information that happens. A lot of people are making art. They always do a public event at the end of the residency to like show the work that's been produced. Although sometimes the work that's produced happens years later. People like get to know each other, do a little small scale collaboration, and then, you know, like over the next 2 years, they'll collaborate on some larger project, basically. But the nice thing about it is, because it's geographically so close to us, we're often able to get these master artists to come to campus and give a guest lecture. And so Jonty Harrison will be here next Tuesday, not during this class time. He's actually going to be here during my previous class, the Arsonic World, the first year seminar that I teach. So if you don't have a class Tuesday, Thursday at 11:30, I would encourage you to come hear him speak about his work and hopefully present some examples of his work. It's going to be at 25L in the library, which is down in the basement, okay? I'll try to remind you again on Thursday and send out a reminder early next week, basically. But I'm not sure if I put this in the syllabus or not. And if I didn't, I'm sorry that I didn't, basically. But it's not a required event. I realize because Tuesday, Thursday, 11:30 is a popular time for classes. If you've got a class conflict that you cannot get out of, by all means, if it's a class that you think you can miss that day and you need me as your professor to email your professor in that class to say, hey, we have this guest artist coming from the UK. Could you please excuse them to let them sit in on the topic? Let me know, and I'll be happy to do that for you with your professor. But I wanted to give you a heads up that it's next week, Tuesday at 11:30, okay, Library 25L. Okay, so we're getting started on processing today, okay? And some of you have already taken a peek at the concept map from Blackboard. But these are the four different areas that we're effectively going to be working in. And we will, I will assign groups to specific quadrants in here. I've broken you up into three groups, which means that one quadrant will not be addressed through the group process. And I suspect that because FFTs requires, how shall we put it, some higher order math than some that most of you are used to, I have a feeling that FFTs will probably be the candidate for what we don't cover through the group process. But that'll be okay because FFTs actually factor into machine listening. So when we get to the machine listening unit, everybody will be doing some things with FFTs through that process, basically, because of the fact that to do pitch perception, you actually need to perform FFT in order to figure out what pitch is being played, basically. Okay. So looking up here, are there some familiar names up here? Some familiar effects processing that you've heard of? What do you see? Convolution? Okay. Okay. Live sampling. What's live sampling? Anybody familiar with live sampling? Or if I say live looping, do you know what that is?
If you say something, it just loops back whatever you said into it.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? Live looping? If I use names like Andrew Bird or Tune Yards, or I'm trying to think of who other artists that are out there doing live looping stuff. Either of those names ring a bell? No. Okay. You should check them out, basically. Live looping and live sampling is the process of effectively recording something and then having it immediately available for usage in live performance. Okay, so rather than the recording process like we handle in the 361 class, where we are recording it and we're tweaking it ad nauseum until we get the final product and we bounce it down and that's the final mix of our project, it's the process of recording something and immediately using it for playback. Okay. And what live looping does is, you actually perform loop-based music on the fly, often with a solo performer. So you have a solo performer that's able to perform two bars And that all of a sudden starts looping, and then they perform the next two bars, that starts looping, they perform the next two bars, that starts looping, and they're actually able to build up very rich, dense textures as a solo artist using this live looping effect. Okay. The broader category would be live sampling. So there's other things you can do with live sampling. Filters, what are filters? Okay, filter certain frequencies out, or, I mean, include, okay. Filters. Well, let's see, you guys that did physical modeling, right, you had filters, right? This name...
Sound familiar?
Okay. The text is too small?
Yeah.
Okay.
What are if I change the lighting? Or is the lighting? That better? Yeah. Resonant filters?
Yeah.
Talk about your exciter resonators, right?
Yeah. Right? I know Leo knows this. Yes. What was the resonator? In a sense, it was a filter. Okay,
yeah.
You're filtering something that is a noisy sound source through a resonant filter to get the overall effect that you're after. Okay, there's a number of other types of filters, and there is a school of thought in audio signal processing which basically says all forms of processing are a filter. Okay, so filters becomes kind of a meta category for all types of processing, because you can look at it as this is the input, this is the output, how did it change, and that's what my filter did. Okay. I'll talk a little bit more about that next week. Let's see, delays. What is a delay? Do you see any other familiar names over here on this edge of the concept map?
Chorus, fading, flange.
Yeah. Yeah, reverb, I kind of situated in the middle, okay. But to give you kind of the landscape here, I mean, phasing, flanging, and chorusing are very popular recording post-production effects, right? They are all attached to this very common thread of them being variable delay lines. In other words, you vary the amount of time that you're delaying the signal in order to get those effects. How you vary the delay time depends on whether you get flanging, chorusing, or phasing. Okay? So it's actually possible to develop one patch that produces these three different effects. And those three different effects all have different uses in record production, post-production. Okay? What about echoes? Echo effects, multi-tap delays. Have you heard of these things?
I've heard of them all. I've heard of multi-tap. I'm not sure what it is, though. Echo was just an echo.
Okay. Just an echo. But what does just an echo mean? Because we use that word a lot.
It's like at the time when the sound starts, like it's delayed, it gives it a sense of like going down a hallway, there's like a certain delay between each peak.
Yeah, there's a discrete copy of an event that happens and it's repeated over and over again. Yeah, I mean, people verbally say echo, 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 that sort of thing, okay? That's an echo effect, okay? In between filters and delays, and this is intentional, is where we would situate artificial reverbs. So it's actually the combination of filters and delays as building blocks that allow you to create artificial reverbs. Like if you're familiar with Logic, right, the gold verb, the platinum verb, those things, those are actually networks of filters and delays that are being used to create those artificial reverb sounds. Okay. That's different than convolution reverbs, which you said you'd heard of. Where have you heard of convolution before?
Alex and the DAW I use.
Yeah.
It's load in a sample and creates a reverb based on the sample.
Yeah. So a sample delay where you've basically sampled the sound of the room and then you're applying it to a new sound, that's all handled through FFTs and convolution. Okay. That's what that's doing. Okay. But as I said, FFTs requires a little bit more math than I have a feeling a lot of you are going to be comfortable with. So I will cover next week some of what goes into FFTs and understanding what they mean, but I don't want to get ahead of myself, okay? So I've given you kind of this logistic lay of the land, okay? Next up for your perusal, if you go to the Blackboard site under processing, and I put them in reverse order with like the newest first, you'll see that I've created a patch here called the Processing Object Overview Patch. So if you go ahead and copy this and use that whole new from clipboard trick inside of Max, you should get something like this. And this is my fall break present to you. Okay? Because this is one, this was one thing I noticed in most of the presentations we had so far, is that the lack of speaking to specific objects that enable you to do specific key objects that enable you to do or realize the effect that you were presenting on. Okay, and I would like you to get in the habit of, you know, talking about, well, we implemented a, I'll just use an example, a comb filter, and we used the comb tilde object for that, okay? So think about how you can incorporate a little bit of a Max lesson into it, because remember, different groups are handling different topics, so not everybody is seeing all the objects that you are, okay? Don't feel like you have to explain every object, but where there are two, maybe three key objects that enable you to realize your project, highlight those objects in your presentation. Does that make sense, what I'm saying there? Okay. So just like when I was giving the presentation on Markov, I was highlighting the anal object and the prob object. Highlight two or three key specific objects that someone in a future project could use to realize the same effect that you did in your presentation. Okay. So my heads up to each group here, basically. I'm basically providing you with a collection of objects that enable these different processing effects, okay? That's not to say that you have to use all of these objects. That's not to say that you will use all of these objects, but start the hunt with these objects, okay, in terms of trying to implement these different effects, okay? This will hopefully jumpstart the process for you. And some of these you might recognize already because you ended up using them in physical modeling, the tap-in, tap-out object. In, let's see, subtractive synthesis, you were using probably biquad in the filter graph, correct? Or were you using resin? Resin, okay. So, yeah, so some of these might be familiar. You've used them in a limited capacity or as part of the synthesis technique that you were working on. What I want you to do in this, they now become the focus of your work, okay, and embellishing and working with them and creating something, some sort of effective musical demonstration with these processing effects, okay. As the slide says, you use a microphone for this project to actually filter a live source or process a live source, okay. So it's required that you use a microphone this time around. Okay, that's one of the required elements. And just so we keep better track of those, I've started a list down here where if I've listed this one item, but I will undoubtedly add one or two more as the weeks go on of things I think you need to include in your presentation. Okay, hopefully that I don't intend for that list to get too long though. Okay. But just some added elements that I want you to use, okay? So let's see. I don't necessarily want to spend time today going through each one of these collections of objects, but what this should allow you to do is take this patch, and if you're curious about what AllPass does, obviously you can open up the help patch for AllPass and find out what AllPass does, okay? There's also these handy, in all most of the help patches, there's also these handy plot diagrams which show you what your filter is actually doing. And you'll see me use some similar graphs to this in explaining them next week, okay? But use these as a path to understanding what these different objects do, okay, and to get you started. Now, I'm not saying that this is the end of where your search goes, but this should certainly jumpstart the beginning of the process for you. Yes? Okay. Any questions about this? We've kind of gone through the concept map, and I've discussed what each one does, or what each quadrant is more or less about. I will say, I put artificial reverb in the middle here. I'm not anticipating, and I would strongly caution against some group from tackling artificial reverb as what they do for this project, basically. You're going to learn about the building blocks for artificial reverb, and maybe in some future project after this class, maybe next semester in Computer Music 2, actually build an artificial reverb, okay? So you can understand how those components all fit together, okay? But for now, stay focused on delays, filters, live sampling, and or FFTs, okay? So I'm transitioning now to talking about your group assignments, okay? These are the group assignments that I see that I'd like to put forward today, okay? I don't know, do you, and I want these groups to pick which area they're going to be researching for this project coming up before we leave here. Do you need 5 minutes to discuss, or that'd be nice? Okay, so take 5 minutes, discuss, well, I don't know. I don't know that you need 5 minutes, 3 minutes to discuss. Put the pressure on, right? Okay. Do you need, so everybody knows their group members. Make sure you introduce each other, and then I'll put the concept map back up. Yeah. We will go in order of whatever the Uzi tells us. How many do you guys know the Uzi object? When it receives one bang, it shoots out the number of bangs that is the argument. It's very handy when you need like 20 things to happen right in a row, or 50 or 256 or whatever. I need 3 things to happen right away by pressing this button. There we go. Okay. Oh, I forgot about 0. Okay, so we have to add. Can we agree to add 1 to each of these? Oh, you guys are. Do I? You want to start? You're gonna cry. You're gonna cry foul and start over. Let's start over. I should have numbered your groups 0 to 1. So rather than. To be fair, I have to clear this now, though. I'm adding to the number of objects I have to add in my interface. Okay, clear. Clear this. Ready? Okay, 1, 3, 2. Okay. So group 1, Michael and Monica. What? Delays. Delays is off the board. 3 is next.
Sampling.
Sampling. So number 2. Filters, okay. Okay. So we've got our quadrants for study, okay? We've got group assignments. The next step is always going to the library. So in looking at your resources from last time and the first time, and reflecting on ways to better get you engaged and get you connected with good resources, should we make a trip to the library with the time that we have left and help you get your first couple of resources? We've got.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Sure.
Okay.
Field trip.
Okay. Library field trip. That's what we're doing with the rest of our day. Okay. Each group has their topic. Remember that from the library, your goal is to get something from the reserve shelf, something from the main shelves, and then something online. I'll leave that to you guys to get outside of class. Yes? Yeah.
We use a textbook that's on the subject that's not in the library. If I find something online.
Let's talk as we make our trip.
Okay.